GRT has also canceled Ion service from Conestoga Mall to Fairview Park Mall in both directions. Shuttle buses are running instead. We have a full list of cancellations at kitchener.citynews.ca. Freezing rain will likely last until it turns to rain in the afternoon. Up to 8 millimeters of ice is expected to build up, which could cause tree branches to break. Here's our weather specialist, John Wilson.
It all depends on the ground temperature and what happens to that raindrop when it hits that. If it's zero or below, it can freeze on contact into rime ice, and that's freezing rain.
Wind gusts up to 70 kilometers an hour could also lead to power outages. Jermaine Ma, City News.
City News time 10:01, checking the drive-in. Here's Eva.
Good morning. If you are eastbound or westbound on the 401 right now, overall, everything is moving quite well. We've got just some volume delays eastbound on the 401 as you make your way from Winston Churchill to east of Mississauga Road. The roads are still quite icy and slick in many areas through Cambridge, Kitchener-Waterloo, and even through the Wellesley area, as well as through Stratford. So you do just want to make sure that you are driving carefully and according to the changing road conditions. Now, if you are on Highway 78 through Kitchener-Waterloo in New Hamburg, no delays and no collisions. And it looks like your routes through Kitchener-Waterloo, also no collisions or delays. We do have construction, though, in Kitchener on Ottawa Street from Old Chicopee Drive to River Road. It's closed off for sewer work. And also Victoria Street from Weber Street to Margaret. It is partially closed, and that's all because of ongoing utility work. Now with a check on the forecast, here's John Wilson.
Barely zero today. We could crawl above the line. We'd lose the freezing rain threat. But right now we have it. Rain falling into below freezing air at the ground. When it hits something that's below freezing, it freezes into ice. And I don't think it'll have a chance on the way down to turn to an ice pellet and bounce first. So that's a problem. Wind, 25 millimeter rainfall, all combined for a special weather statement, plus the freezing rain warning. And then we rise to 8 with rain tonight, 10 with showers tomorrow, and 5 with showers on Friday. Today's high zero.
We're getting light rain right now as we sit at the freezing mark. The leaders of NATO, including Prime Minister Justin Trudeau and U.S. President Joe Biden, are set to hold 2 days of emergency meetings in Brussels, all to talk about the latest developments from the war in Ukraine. Our Laura Carney has the details.
The Prime Minister has arrived in Brussels, where he will address the European Parliament at 12:30 our time. Justin Trudeau is expected to stress the importance of countries on both sides of the Atlantic working together to defend democracy in the face of Russia's invasion of Ukraine. This comes ahead of tomorrow's emergency NATO meeting. Leaders also expected to attend the European Council meeting. The Council President tells CNN they have one goal.
We must make sure that Putin will be defeated.
U.S. President Joe Biden will be in Belgium tomorrow. CNN's Natasha Bertrand says he's expected to announce new sanctions against Russia.
But there will also be a lot of discussions about Russia's role in the international community. Because of Russia's illegal, they say, war against Ukraine, one of the things that they are likely going to discuss is this call by Poland now to expel Russia from the G20.
Laura Carney, City News.
Well, it is World Puppy Day. Our local police are recognizing their top dogs on the job in the canine unit. Waterloo Regional Police have 4 dogs, Chase, Grim, Ranger, and Tracker. Between the group, they say the pups conducted 338 tracks and recovered 36 property-related items last year. They also assisted in the arrest of 14 people, police thanking their pups for helping keep the community safe. In sports, the Leafs hosting the New Jersey Devils tonight. It'll be the first game with Mark Giordano as part of the team. And we've got the game live here on City News 570 starting at 7 o'clock. Elsewhere today, the Blue Jays continuing on their spring training schedule. They play the Phillies at 1 o'clock. And it'll be a busy night at the Odd, an 8 p.m. puck drop for what is the NHL Top Prospects game. Download the City News 570 app at kitchener.citynews.ca. Your next news update at 10:30. I'm Stuart McGinn.
If knowledge is power, consider this show your Sword of Grayskull. Welcome to the Mike Farwell Show on City News 570.
Welcome back to the Mike Farwell Show on City News 570, and welcome in to our viewers on Rogers TV Channel 20, who join the show every day from 10 till noon. I am not Mike Farwell. I am producer Paulie. Mike Farwell is not feeling well today. Perhaps he will be back tomorrow. So you're stuck with me hosting today till noon. Well, the corner of Francis and Charles Street in downtown Kitchener will be home to the Waterloo region's tallest condo tower. Kitchener councilors approved the 532 residential unit development at a council meeting on Monday night. And joining us to discuss this vote is Debbie Chapman, Ward 9 councilor for the city of Kitchener. Debbie, welcome to the program.
Thank you for having me. Good morning.
Good morning. Now, when you and I chatted about this a couple of weeks ago when I was hosting Kitchener Today, now the proposal, it was a proposed development at that point, but now it is a permanent, it has been voted on. Now, just to back up, what plot of land are we talking about in the downtown Kitchener area?
Yeah, it's currently a vacant parking lot. I don't even know how heavily it's used as a parking lot, but it is just a concrete pad right at the corner of Charles and Francis. The actual address is 30 Francis.
30 Francis.
Yeah.
What does this development look like? Is it all residential or is it a mixture of residential and commercial?
Yeah, it's a mixed-use build, which means there is residential and there is commercial. So the ground level will be commercial, fronting on Charles and also on Francis. And the remainder, there's I think it's a six-story, I'm not sure if I've got that right, but there's a podium, and then on top of the podium is the are the residential units, which would be a total height of 44 stories.
Now, if I'm not mistaken, yourself and John Gazzola were the only two votes against this. Is that right?
Yes, that's correct.
So what were your major objections to this proposal?
Yeah, so my concerns are primarily to do with the way it's being justified. So when we talk about one of the main things, what takes us from what would essentially be a four-story, given the current zoning, would be allow probably about a four-story building. And to go from there to a 44-story building, the way it has been framed is that we've permitted bonusing. But the bonusing has been applied without specific numbers. So In our 2019 zoning bylaw document, which this part of bonusing was never passed, but it's the only guidelines we actually have to work from because there are no other guidelines that tell us what bonusing would amount to if it were applied. So things like parkland might give you one more story, or things like if you have certain environmental sustainability features, you might get another story on your building. The way this plan was presented to us, or this proposal was presented to us, it listed all the things that would merit bonusing, but without a breakdown of what that would look like. So it's very vague and unclear to me how we go from four stories to 44 stories. So that was one of my biggest problems. But I also, it's also, we hear over and over again about density ratios and how we have to meet these goals by 2031. And if you look at the numbers in the recent urban growth management strategy review, the report that we received late last year, it tells us that we already have 212 people in jobs per hectare in the downtown area. Mm-hmm. The goals that we set out, or that the province requires of us, are 200 jobs and people per hectare.
So it already exceeds that.
We already exceed that, but in fairness, the city's official plan raised that density goal to 225 by 2031. So we have 212, according to the current counts, and to reach 225 by 2031, that doesn't include 30 Francis Street and any of the other big developments that are being proposed. The other thing is, if we were to take, in that same report, it details that if we were to take the properties in downtown at the zoning that they currently are, so that would be Francis would be four stories, not 44, and we took all the other properties that are not currently under development, we would have a total of 334 persons in jobs per hectare. So again, I mean, we're way above. We far exceed and will far exceed the guidelines. My third point, and I didn't really bring this up at the council meeting, but we had a presentation on Monday the 7th to do with the Housing for All strategy and an update to that report that was passed in 2020. And the city highlights the use of equity, diversity, and inclusion principles to realize the right to housing. And in the report, the priority number 3 refers to helping to end homelessness. And 4 refers to securing community affordable rental and affordable ownership housing options. So if we really want to meet these goals, we have to look at every development proposal through those lenses, right, of equity, diversity, and inclusion. And if we want to end homelessness and secure affordable housing ownership, I would say that this proposal does not do any of the above. So I think, you know, we don't have current updated zoning bylaws or a property downtown core at this point. We've just finished upgrading the residential zoning bylaws, but we haven't done the downtown core bylaws or the major transit station area bylaws. So all I'm saying is let's get those bylaws in place so that so that residents aren't feeling they have to come to us at every move and every proposal to say, well, wait, what do the bylaws say? Well, if we went by the current bylaws, we'd have 4 stories at Francis Street, and nobody's suggesting that that's what we should have. But we have no guidelines and no real plan for what we want the downtown to look like. And in fact, all we're doing is sort of reacting for every proposal that comes forward. So I don't know if that sort of summarizes where we sit on this whole thing. And this developer, the N8, also has owned 2 other properties in the downtown core, and although a proposal has not come to us, but when I spoke to them, they plan to propose a 46-story building at the corner of Charles and Gockel in Ontario, that area, and another 46-story building at Queen and Charles. Mm-hmm. So again, I mean, there are no zoning bylaws that would match that the way they currently are. So if what the city would like to propose and what council would approve is 44 stories plus all around downtown, then let's say that. But if that's not what we're proposing, then let's figure out what we are proposing.
Now, about a month ago, Kitchener Council approved, I believe it was a 10-story building in Belmont Village. I remember there were concerns that even that was too high. And the 10 stories was the maximum height for a building. Was that only because, like, in that neighborhood? Like, because Belmont is this quaint little village?
Well, I think the thing there, first of all, the maximum height there is 8. They introduced a section of the official plan that would allow them to add 50% under certain conditions and circumstances. What came out of that was that, yes, some of us argued that Belmont Village is a unique place and really the only village as such in the city, not the region. Of course, we've got St. Jacob's Village, which is very unique. Mm-hmm. But there's no sort of secondary plan for Belmont Village that would, again, determine what do we want to see in the village. So this is very different, right? The downtown. Yeah. I mean, they're the same in the sense that they're, you know, what do we envision? Is it just about building and building? Mostly one bedroom condos, 500-600 square feet. Is that that to me isn't very diverse, and mm-hmm. it's not very accessible to many people financially because the sure it may be cheaper than $1 million home out in the suburbs, but it doesn't meet the needs of many people, you know, especially families.
So this development, the corner of Charles and Francis and Kitchener, 44 stories. So is your contention that that's too tall?
I'm not as concerned about the height of the building in that location. It's more, how did we get to that? And so I try to approach these things objectively and say, okay, what does our official plan say? What are our zoning bylaws? What does the region, but also the province require of us? And go from there and sort of piece all those parts together and say, okay, this is a great proposal. And to the credit of the developer, they did make adjustments. And initially, there wasn't going to be commercial on all the sides of the building on the main floor, and they increased that. They agreed to give more money to Indwell, who's going to build some affordable housing in a church in downtown. And those are all positive things. Of course, the affordable housing piece is kind of interesting. So you give $600,000 to a not-for-profit, and of course, that's wonderful. It'd be nice if all these new buildings, if we had inclusionary zoning, that the buildings themselves would have that diverse range of housing so that people could live, you know, in different parts of the city, not just in subsidized housing.
So do we know when the construction of this development might start and then when it might be open?
Oh, it's going to take a couple of years, I think, to be open. I noticed there's already activity happening on the property. So I would imagine it's going to start in the spring. Well, it's kind of already starting, the fact that there's activity there.
Councillor Chapman, thank you very much for your time this morning.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me and have a good day.
You too. Debbie Chapman is Ward 9 councillor for the city of Kitchener, joining us this morning to talk about this 44-story condo development, well, mix of residential and commercial, which was approved by city of Kitchener council on Monday night. And 532 residential units will be in this building. 44 stories, again, at the corner of Francis and Charles Street in downtown Kitchener. That is right next to, I believe, where the U-Haul, rental place is. Yeah, right next to where U-Haul is now. And if you're familiar with our old location, the radio station, literally just a half a block from there. So we have 44 stories in downtown Kitchener, going to be the tallest building yet in downtown Kitchener. Be interested to hear your thoughts on this at 519-570-2545. Out of town, 1-800-570-5715 and star 570. The corner of Francis and Charles Street in downtown Kitchener will soon be home to a 44-story apartment building. This is the Mike Farwell Show. Producer Pauly in with you today on City News 570.
You've got something to say. Now it's time to say it on the Mike Farwell Show. Call 519-570-2545 or 1-800-570-5715.
This hour of the Mike Farwell Show.
Mike Farwell Show on City News 570.
I'm not as concerned about the height of the building in that location. It's more, how did we get to that? And so I try to approach these things objectively and say, okay, what do the official plans say? What are our zoning bylaws? What does the province require of us? And go from there.
Debbie Chapman, Ward 9 councillor for the City of Kitchener, joining us a few moments ago here on the Mike Farwell Show. Producer Paul Ian with you today. By the way, Mike Farwell is a little under the weather. Yeah, this 44-story condo tower set to go up in downtown Kitchener that was approved by City of Kitchener Council on Monday night, corner of Francis and Charles Street in downtown Kitchener. It's an interesting balancing act, isn't it? You know, you have to balance the housing needs of the city with what neighborhood residents might want, or just with what might be out of place with the neighborhood. Debbie commented on, you know, how did we get here? Because our old building in downtown Kitchener, corner of King and Water Street, that we are in for many, many, many years, this radio station, an 11-story building if you count the penthouse, which is where the studios were located. That was an 11-story building, and when that was built, that, I believe, was the tallest building in Waterloo Region for many years. I remember when the Manulife building opened right next to Grand River Hospital, or I think it was KW Hospital at the time. What a big deal that building was when it opened in the late 80s, and people were saying if you go up to the very top floor, on a clear day, you can see the CN Tower. That was the claim anyway. I never tested it for myself, but yeah, so these buildings keep getting taller and taller, and we seem to jump from, you know, 10, 15 stories all the way up to 44 stories. That'll be by far the tallest building in the region to date. Mike, go ahead.
I never hear the question I always have is, these places, before they were bulldozing it, that U-Haul spot, that's maybe paying $20,000 a year in taxes. When they put up 550 condos, they're going to be taking in like $1.5 million in taxes. Uh-huh. So why are they not lowering everybody else's taxes around town by, you know, $1.5 million? Where's all the money going? This goes on and on and on everywhere in Kitchener-Waterloo, where they used to take in $20,000, they're taking in $1 million or more. Where does all the money go? I don't know why you people don't ever ask these socialists that infest the city. What do they do with it all?
It's an interesting question. The money spent by various governments seems to go up and up and up. It rarely goes down, it seems. Mike, that was an interesting question. That, you know, if the tax revenue generated by this condo development is going to be X amount of dollars, if it's going to be in the millions or even, you know, billions of dollars, whatever it might be, can that offset maybe a tax decrease for other areas? Interesting question. You know, if I'm ever on to talk about something like this again, maybe I will ask a question like that. That's something actually, Mike, that I had not thought about. Mary, go ahead.
Oh, hi. Well, my opinion is that if they're going to do all this building, shouldn't there be an overall plan of the city or the city center to show people what at the end it will look like?
Well, I'm sure there's renderings around that were probably presented at council meetings or whatever. Maybe if you can see them in the newspaper, I'm assuming,
well,
or even
I
on our
know.
Website.
The lady that was against this one, is there enough green space? But on top of that, personally, I live in Kitchener. I don't find it very pleasant to go downtown Kitchener. I would rather go downtown Waterloo, which is quaint. Kitchener, the skyscape, is just a higgledy-piggledy bunch of building. Mm-hmm. Nothing pretty. And if you're going to only build one-bedroom condos, what family, you know? Mm-hmm. I thought you were encouraging different kinds.
Yeah, that's a good point. Although I guess, I don't know, maybe for one-bedroom might be, I don't know, maybe a starter unit for somebody. Then after couple of years living there. Maybe they move into a, you know, a three-bedroom house as their family expands or whatever. But yeah, it is interesting to note that all of these units in this 44-story tower will be one-bedroom units. Still lots to come here on the Mike Farwell Show with producer Paulie filling in. Coming up in an hour, we're doing free... what did Mike call it last week? Free phones with Farwell, something like that. There's, you know, people have been asking for more open line time, more phone calls on the radio station. So we'll be doing that today from 11:30 till noon. So really anything you want to call in and talk about is fair game between 11:30 and noon. Coming up after the news, it's our weekly What's on Wednesday feature. We have a couple of things to talk about here on the Mike Farwell Show. Producer Paulie filling in on City News 570.
Look at that. Somebody found Mike Farwell's off switch. He's off for a few minutes. But the Mike Farwell Show returns after this on City News 570. Simulcast on Rogers TV, Cable 20.
This hour of the Mike...
Right now at the freezing mark and a cloudy sky breaking the rain. I'm Stuart McGinn with the City News 570 top story. We are still under that freezing rain warning and special weather statement this hour, but we haven't had many reports of collisions this morning. Temperatures managing to stay mostly above the freezing mark. It's been good news so far. Still, though, school buses were canceled locally and schools are closed for the day. It's a remote learning day. Temperatures are set to continue warming up through the afternoon and evening, so eventually this will all just switch over to rain. And that will last into the overnight hours. According to Environment Canada, our region could get up to 25 millimeters of rain by tomorrow. Look for Prime Minister Justin Trudeau to talk about Canada's solidarity with Ukraine when he speaks to the European Parliament later on today. Trudeau's speech will stress the importance of countries on both sides of the Atlantic working together to defend democracy in the face of Russia's unprovoked invasion of Ukraine. That invasion now going on for nearly a month. While in Brussels, Trudeau will also take part in a NATO summit and a meeting of G7 leaders to discuss the crisis in Ukraine. And Moderna says its COVID vaccine works in babies, toddlers, and preschoolers. The company says it plans to ask in North America and Europe the regulators to authorize two small-dose shots for youngsters under the age of 6 within just the next few weeks. If approved, that would mean shots could be ready by the summer. While COVID-19 generally isn't as dangerous to children as to adults, some do still become severely ill. Follow City News 570 on Twitter at City News KIT. Your next news update at 11 o'clock. I'm Stuart McGinn.
He's driving the motorcycle, and we're just sitting in the sidecar along for the ride. We return to the Mike Farwell Show on City News 570.
To the Mike Farwell Show here on City News 570. I am not Mike Farwell. I'm producer Paulie, in for Mike today. He's not feeling that well. Well, time now for our weekly What's on Wednesday feature, where we highlight some of the different things happening in and around our region. So our first interview is with Sue Simpson. She is executive director of the Waterloo Region Family Network, and they are preparing for their annual, what they're calling, Evening of Elegance. And we're going to find out more about that right now. Sue, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much, Paul. It's really nice to join you.
Now, tell me more about the Waterloo Region Family Network.
I'm happy to. So we are a peer-driven and peer-developed support network for families who have children or a loved one in their family who has an exceptional need. And when we refer to exceptional needs, we mean physical, developmental, communication, or mental health needs. So that could be a loved one with cerebral palsy, autism, learning disabilities, or perhaps not even a formal diagnosis. And we support them by helping them facilitate meaningful connections with each other. So connecting parents with parents and families with families, as well as connecting them to vital resources in our community.
So I'm assuming this is a non-profit organization.
That is correct. We've been around for 13 years and we are, yes, a nonprofit.
Okay, well, I'm honest, Sue. Prior to this morning, I had not heard of you. So it's good to know that an organization with such a broad umbrella like that exists in Waterloo Region. That's great.
Thank you. We're pleased to be able to be here to support the many families who need us in our community and always looking to support other families. So please connect with us if you need to.
So your annual Evening of Elegance. So where did this idea begin? You said this has been on for, this is the 13th year, is that right?
This is actually the 7th year, so our organization has been around for 13 years.
That's where I got 13 from.
Yep,
I apologize. Go ahead.
No problem. So 7 years, this will be our 7th annual, what we call signature event. So it's the main fundraising event that we have through the year. And it's an opportunity for community members to come to learn more about the organization, to have a lovely evening. It's going to be a little bit different this year as it will be a sit down dinner. So we want to maintain everyone's safety, still come to learn about the organization, the supports that we provide, to hear some family stories or learn about family stories and those that we support from that perspective. There's going to be a raffle and a silent auction. And so we really needed, because we are not ministry funded, we needed to find ways to fundraise. And this was a way that our whole staff team and volunteers could be involved. Our families can come if they wish and also share information with the wider community.
So what can people expect if they buy a ticket for the Evening of Elegance? What's going to happen?
So they're going to come and have a lovely time. It's going to be very elegant, as we said. It's going to be a sit-down dinner at St. George Banquet Hall in Waterloo, so a different location this year. On Saturday, April the 30th, doors will open at 6 p.m. There will be a little bit of time for mixing and mingling and finding your table, and then we will enjoy a lovely sit-down dinner. Then we will have an amazing speaker. I don't want to give that away, but I want to share that it's an amazing speaker who's going to share some of her life journey,
all right,
which I think will be definitely resonate with people and will be very impactful. There's an opportunity to purchase raffle tickets with some great prizes and also some amazing silent auction items. We will have staff available as well to answer questions of anyone who's a guest who might wish to learn more about the organization.
Do you have a fundraising goal in mind for this event?
We do. Our fundraising goal is, we do have one, and where things are a little bit different this year from that perspective, because with COVID and things changing all of the time. So we are really, really hopeful that we can raise about $15,000 to $20,000.
And who benefits from the funds that you're hoping to raise?
the families that we support. So all of the funds go towards supporting those families through our various programs. We have a parent mentor program. We have various support groups where we provide the support for families. We have support through our family resource coaches who can provide personal guidance to each family to connect them to the resources that are available in the community. We have some self-advocate groups, so all kinds of different things. And so the funds will go to supporting all of those programs and really then to support those families.
So I was reading on the website for this event, it was mentioned the Matthew McGregor Award for Volunteerism. Is that part of the event or is that something separate?
It is part of the event. So we have always had a volunteer award. And so it is named after a young man who passed away a couple of years ago, who family have been involved with our organization. And he really represented community and connections, which is what our organization is all about. And so his parents will be there to be able to present the award to our volunteers who have been chosen this year to receive the award.
So how do people get involved? How can they buy tickets or even make a donation if that's all they want to do?
So the best thing is to go to our website, which is wrfn.info, and you will see right on the front page, the landing page, information about Evening of Elegance. There's an opportunity there to purchase tickets. You will also see a donate button at the top of the landing page as well. And we appreciate all the support that people are willing to give.
How much are tickets for the event?
Tickets are now, they were on early bird for a little while. They are now on full price, which is $125 per ticket.
That's not too bad for such a good cause. That's great. All right. Yeah. Thank you very much, Sue.
Thank you so much, Paul. We really appreciate the opportunity, and I hope you have a great day.
You too. Sue Simpson is Executive Director of the Waterloo Region Family Network, and their website is WRFN. That's WRFN.info, and they have their annual Evening of Elegance coming up. It's Saturday, April 30th. So that is, I guess that would be next Saturday. Time's flying this year, is it not? Saturday, April 30th at St. George Banquet Hall. That's on King Street in Waterloo. So right here in town, doors open at 6 p.m. And again, for more information on that, you can go to wrfn.info for more information on the Waterloo Region Family Network or to purchase tickets for this event. Again, they're calling it the annual Evening of Elegance. This is producer Pauly filling in on the Mike Farwell Show on City News 570.
Want to get a word in? Call the Mike Farwell Show now. 519-570-2545. More of the show right after this on City News 570.
This hour of the Mike Farwell Show.
Table 20.
Welcome back to the Mike Farwell Show here on City News 570. Producer Polly in with you today. It's our weekly What's On Wednesday feature. Well, St. Mary's General Hospital and Grand River Hospitals are joining forces to raise up to 10, or probably maybe more than $10 million. Hopefully the more the merrier, right? $10 million to expand MRI capacity in Waterloo region. And to join us on the phone, we have Susan Dusick. She is CEO of the St. Mary's General Hospital Foundation, and Paul McIntyre Royston, who is president and CEO of the Grand River Hospital Foundation. Susan and Paul, welcome to the show.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Now, is this a unique situation that the two major hospitals in the region are combining forces for a singular cause? I don't think I've ever heard of that before.
Well, I don't know that I'd say it's unique. It's been done in other jurisdictions and other hospitals in the province. But I think for Kitchener-Waterloo, it's one of the first times. Let me reflect. We joined forces with the region's hospitals for Region Ready at the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic, and that was quite successful. But I think Paul and I agreed that this just made sense to talk to the community jointly because this will make all boats rise relative to MRI.
Yeah, and one of the really neat aspects of this program in particular is actually it's the same staff. So St. Mary's and Grand River have a number of integrated programs.
Oh, okay.
And so, yeah, both the medical director as well as the chief physician involved in the program they work at both hospitals. And so it's a natural place, and new MRIs in the region is just going to be so powerful.
So you're trying to raise money for some new MRI machines. Now, I didn't know this until I read this morning. St. Mary's does not have an MRI. All the MRIs in the region, maybe there's only one, are at Grand River. So that obviously we're hoping to get one at St. Mary's at least, right?
Correct. So St. Mary's has never had an MRI, which is very, very challenging and complicated for our patients that require MRI, particularly as it relates to our cardiac program. So presently, very fragile patients have to be transported to Grand River, and we have to care for them there and then bring them back. And it's very challenging because it requires staff to accompany them. So it takes several resources out of play for a period of time, and it's not ideal to be transporting fragile patients when we know that they have delicate conditions. And secondarily, what we have to do is then use a different modality. So sometimes we're exposing them to different diagnostic tools in order to gain the same information, or in some cases we have to just go with what we have in terms of diagnostic information. And again, that's not ideal for patients, and that doesn't speak to the depth of quality of care.
And so, Paul, what kind of stress does a lack of MRIs in Waterloo Region put on the healthcare system?
It's tough, right? It really is an incredible tool to be able to see critical parts of the body in a very unique way. I know my own daughter, we actually had to go down to Toronto for an MRI. So for us, when the province did an announcement in December that they were going to pay for the operating dollars of two new MRIs, we were overjoyed. Now, we weren't overjoyed for the fact that when they do that, the communities have to come and find the money to raise it. But we knew this community was going to be responsive and engaging. You know, Grand River has the only hospital MRI in the communities. And wonderfully, last year, Equitable donated $4.5 million to upgrade that to a brand new one. So we actually have one brand new MRI, and this will provide a second brand new MRI, which is fantastic, and then give St. Mary's one as well to just completely change that and to reduce the wait times in a significant way in our community.
Yeah, that MRI is running 24/7 currently, is it not?
Yeah, the current MRI, literally, I know my aunt actually had an appointment at 2 in the morning a couple months ago. It's very well used because it's such a critical tool.
So, Susan, what is the wait list for someone looking to get an MRI scan currently? Do you know?
Actually, Paul could speak to that better because he actually has an MRI and I don't.
Right. Good point.
So with sort of urgent cases, They do slip them in, but we're looking, you know, 90 days, 180 days, you know, so under 6 months for like quite urgent. And then for those that are less urgent, the wait time can go on much, much longer than that. So we're anticipating to be just a regular cadence of sort of a 90 day under that. And, you know, that's typical. We know there's this demand. Currently, it's the current ones are only about 17,000 hours a year. I got the math on that. I probably don't have the math on that. 17,000 patients a year. There's my math. And then these two will add incredible capacity because, as Susan said, with all the St. Mary's cardiac patients having to come over to Grand River, that also takes the Grand River time away. So it's going to free right. up a huge, huge swath of space on those MRIs.
And Susan, one of the big benefits of an additional MRI in town is that local residents won't have to travel out of town to get an MRI like they are currently.
Correct. So St. Mary's will not only take care of cardiac patients and the wait list that we have for cardiac access to MRI, because the cardiac testing is just a little bit different. And then we'll also be helping pick up the additional volumes and helping to reduce the wait time for what I'm going to refer to as regular MRI that's not the cardiac specialty. What else is of particular note is that St. Mary's is the only cardiac center in the province of Ontario that doesn't have an MRI machine. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that's acceptable for this community.
Right. So both for Susan and Paul, I guess you could comment on this. Now, everybody thinks, well, you know, we have a government-funded healthcare system. How come they're not paying for it? But it's important to note that the government money only pays for the day-to-day operations of the hospital, but equipment like this, it relies on private donations.
Correct. So you've said it absolutely correctly, that the day-to-day operations are funded by the ministry. There is a little bit of an exception on this particular project in the case of St. Mary's. So at Grand River, as Paul had previously mentioned, they have a unit that's going to go through what's called a de-stream process, which will actually make the unit virtually new, hence the difference in cost for both organizations. So their project is about $2.4 million. The St. Mary's project is $7.6 million. And that's because we also have to do a renovation inside the hospital. Typically, the ministry would help offset some of that, but in this case, St. Mary's just said, we don't have time to wait for the ministry to step up to this. We know our community needs this now, so we're going to take the full burden of both the renovation and the equipment cost, and that's where the 7.6 comes for us. So we want to get it here as quickly as possible in order to be able to care for our community.
And so how can people make a donation if they want to help out with this? Like, this is a fundraiser. Are you holding an event of some sort?
Over the course of the next year, there'll be a series of things. So we'll be working jointly on some direct mail initiatives to the community. There is a gala, which I would actually let Paul speak to. He's actually supporting that on behalf of both organizations that's happening in June. And then there's also a joint website. The community can certainly reach out to us through mrikw.ca.
So, Paul, do you want to talk about that event you're involved with?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, some community members have stepped forward, and they're running an incredible gala at hgala.ca, H-G-A-L-A.ca. And, you know, it's been really great to see. We've sort of been talking about this for sort of quietly for about a month or two, and now we're sort of out in the public, but because we've already had some funds committed toward the goal, which is incredible. You know, and for us, it's every dollar just makes that much of a difference in terms of really bringing it together. And, you know, we love the joint nature of this. You know, it's the imaging for the community, and imaging in particular is so critical in all aspects of medicine. So not only is this with the MRI bringing that up, but our overall imaging for the entire region mm-hmm. will be raised by these contributions to MRIKW.ca. So
do you know the date of the event yet?
Yes, it's on,
June 16th.
Thank you so much, Susan.
You're
I
welcome.
Didn't have it on my notes.
That's okay. We're in this together, Paul.
We like it. We like working together. It's great.
All right, Susan and Paul, thank you very much for your time this morning.
Thank you for having us.
Thanks, Paul.
Thank you. Susan Dusick is president and CEO of the St. Mary's General Hospital Foundation, and Paul McIntyre Royston is president and CEO of the Grand River Hospital Foundation. They are joining forces to try and increase MRI capacity in Waterloo region. And currently Grand River Hospital, I think Paul said Grand River has two MRIs currently, but St. Mary's doesn't have any. And so they're hoping to raise $10 million to expand MRI capacity in Waterloo region. If you do want to make a donation, that website is mrikw.ca. And yeah, we touched on it near the end of the interview. A lot of people, I think, are reluctant to give money to organizations that do rely heavily on government funding. And in a case here in Ontario, really an entirely government-funded healthcare system, but the money that comes from the government only pays for the day-to-day operations, administrative staff, paying doctors, nurses, things like that. If there's a major piece of equipment that's needed, it's not easy for the hospitals to go to the province and say, yeah, can you give me $10 million for a new MRI machine? And so that is why even in areas that are heavily funded by public money, it is important to give to those charities, especially if you're passionate about it. And so very, very important cause. And that's one reason, too, why you shouldn't be afraid to give the charity if you think that government should be covering it, because the more money they raise from charity is less money that they have to rely on for the taxpayer. Hopefully, an increase in private charity will mean a decrease in government funding, which may also mean more money in your pocket as a taxpayer. I don't think anybody is against that. So yes, St. Mary's General Hospital and Grand River General Hospital's teaming up to try and raise $10 million to buy at least one new MRI machine for Waterloo Region. My assumption is that machine will end up going in St. Mary's, because as we said, Grand River Hospital already has two. Again, that website, mrikw.ca. And not to take anything away from Grand River Hospital, I've been there a couple of times. I had an operation there about 18 years ago. But in terms of my personal medical history, I've had a lot more history with St. Mary's Hospital. And every time I've gone in there, the staff are fantastic. I actually had a medical procedure done there just a couple of weeks ago. I'm not going to go into details, but I was there for 4 or 5 hours. I had to recover on one of the beds. I couldn't walk around. I had a little medical procedure, and the staff at St. Mary's were fantastic. And so, let's make this happen. $10 million for a new MRI machine in the region. It'll help cut down those wait times. 82 days right now is the average wait time to get an MRI scan. And now that's here in Waterloo Region. That the provincial average is three times less than that. So we really are in the need of a new MRI machine here in Waterloo Region. So very, very cool initiative. MRIKW.ca. Still to come here on the Mike Farwell Show with me, producer Paulie, filling in. Coming up from 11:30 till noon, it's open phones, free phones. Well, it says on my lineup here, free phones with producer Paulie. That's not very alliterative. Mike Farwell, of course, as we know, loves the alliteration. And because it's not my show, right? It's the Mike Farwell Show. So I'm still tempted to call this free phones with Farwell, even though I'm not Mike Farwell, as you can probably tell. But we just started doing this last week. People have been asking for more open phones. So really, open phones from 11:30 till noon today. Anything you want to talk about. It's kind of a mini version of Free Phones Friday, except on a Wednesday for 30 minutes. So there you go. We have news coming up next, and then more of the Mike Farwell Show with me, producer Paulie, filling in on City News 570.
CKGL AM Kitchener.
Broadcasting live from the boardwalk.
Breaking news, traffic, and weather.
When you need to know, keep it on City News 570.
This hour of the Mike Farwell Show.
is City News 570 everywhere.
It is 11 o'clock, cloudy, windy, and zero. A freezing rain warning and special weather statement remain in effect. Good morning. I'm Paul McPhee with the City News 570 top story. Well, in about a couple of hours, Prime Minister Trudeau will be addressing the European Parliament on his second trip to the continent this month. Once again, Trudeau will be focused on Russia's invasion of Ukraine. City News Parliament Hill reporter Cormac McSweeney joins us with more.
As he addresses the EU representatives, Trudeau is expected to discuss how both sides of the Atlantic need to work together to protect democracy as Russia's war machine continues to run rampant over Ukraine. Foreign Affairs Minister Melanie Joly says the Prime Minister will be reaffirming Canada's solidarity with a continent facing its biggest security challenge since the Second World War.
There is a level of irrationality in the way President Putin is taking decisions. And in that sense, we have to be ready.
Now, this speech will be ahead of a NATO leaders' summit and a G7 meeting taking place tomorrow in Brussels to discuss the next steps in addressing the crisis in Ukraine. Trudeau will be under pressure to boost Canada's defense budget from an estimated 1.4% to 2% of our GDP, as is the NATO commitment. Cormac McSweeney, Parliament Hill.
City News time, 11:01. Time for traffic and weather together on the ones. Here's Eva Fragiscatos.
Good morning. Checking out the eastbound 401 as you make your way through the Cambridge area. Overall, looks pretty good. Road's still a bit wet in some spots, but right now looks like the rain has taken a little bit of a break. If you are eastbound on the 401, it is still slow, though, from Winston Churchill to east of Mississauga Road. Westbound 401, minor delays, Mavis to west of Mississauga Road. And then just taking a look at Highway 6 North and Highway 6 South, no delays or problems there. Highway 24, both directions towards the 401 in Cambridge, also moving quite well at this time. Highway 78 through Kitchener, Waterloo, through New Hamburg and Stratford. It is a collision-free commute on that route. I'm also not finding any major problems along Highway 7 towards the Guelph area. It seems to be in decent shape. Highway 85, both directions, no delays and no problems at this time. Overall, it seems to be moving quite well, and I'm not spotting any collisions or problems on your routes through Waterloo or Kitchener, but we do still have some ongoing long-term construction in Kitchener on Victoria Street from Weaver Street to Margaret Avenue, partially closed off for utility work, and Charles Street at Gockel Street, partially closed for road work. Now with the check on the forecast, here's John Wilson.
Rain we've got. Then it becomes a matter of what's the ground temperature. Is it 0.1? Then it wouldn't be freezing rain. If it's 0.0 or below, it could freeze on contact to ice. So expect that. This morning we have a freezing rain warning, and I don't expect the temperature to move a lot. And eventually we do warm up to 8 degrees, but that's tonight with rain and the special weather statement for rain and wind, as well as the freezing rain warning today. Showers Thursday come with a high of 10, then flurries Thursday night. Friday, showers and 5, flurries Friday night. Today's high is 0.
And right now outside the City News 570 studio, cloudy, windy, and we are at the freezing mark. And we are continuing under a special weather statement and freezing rain warning, causing a messy commute, but also some cancellations. City's Jermaine Ma has the details.
Local public and Catholic schools are closed today, along with school buses canceled. The GRT has also shut down Ion service from Conestoga to Fairview Park Malls, so shuttle buses are running. There is a full list of cancellations up on kitchener.citynews.ca. Now, the freezing rain is what's causing trouble this morning. There could be up to 8 millimeters of ice built up and some tree branches breaking because of that. The wind is a problem as well, with gusts up to 70 kilometers an hour. Environment Canada is warning there could be power and utility outages. Our weather specialist John Wilson says whether freezing rain turns to rain depends on the temperature.
As long as that temperature is 0 or below, the threat of a lot of ice presents itself, and it could last a long while this morning before the temperature climbs, because it doesn't look like it wants to.
It will likely be past noon before it's rain. Jermaine Ma, City News.
In sports, Elise back on home ice tonight hosting the New Jersey Devils. We've got the game live on City News 570 at 7 o'clock. And tonight at the Odd, it's the CHL-NHL Top Prospects game. Puck drop there, 8 o'clock. Be the first to know your news your way any time of day. If it's happening in Waterloo Region, you'll find out about it on City News 570 and at kitchener.citynews.ca. News next at 11:30. I'm Paul McPhee, City News.
Every day is a new battle, so let's arm you with the information you need to survive this day. This is the Mike Farwell Show, simulcast on Rogers TV, Cable 20.
We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Mike Farwell Show here on City News 570. Producer Pauly in with you today. I keep forgetting to mention we're also on Rogers TV Channel 20. So every time I throw to one of the breaks, I should also be shouting out to Carla and company at Rogers TV Cable 20. They join us every weekday from 10 till noon. Well, the bankruptcy file on the Hacienda Event Company is still open with more than $1 million owed to more than 100 couples who had, you know, events booked at this, you know, at this venue before they declared bankruptcy. And I believe that was during the pandemic, probably possibly due to the pandemic. But we've talked about this before on the Mike Farwell Show, but there's a new wrinkle to this story. And Mitch Taylor joins us to discuss the latest development. Mitch, welcome to the show.
Thanks very much for having me, Producer Pauly.
Now, Mitch, you had joined us, I guess maybe it was about a year ago, because you and your partner were set to get married at the Hacienda and were caught up in the bankruptcy. So let's start there. Why did you choose the Hacienda as your wedding venue?
For sure. We chose the Hacienda venue as we thought overall it was just an overall beautiful venue. We've driven by it several times. My wife and I have always, you know, dreamed about having some sort of, you know, Spanish-inspired wedding, and it just seemed very suitable that there was, you know, such a venue very close to us here in Kitchener. And when we went for our initial walkthrough back in, I believe it was the end of 2019, we fell in love with the venue, and we quickly signed a contract agreement to have our wedding there.
And so the wedding was supposed to take place when?
Well, if it wasn't for COVID, our original wedding date, I believe, was sometime in 2020. Mm-hmm. And then we had it rescheduled once COVID hit for September of 2021. And then I believe October 2020, that's when we found out the news.
And so did they call you, or did you get a notice in the mail that the event was no longer going to be happening? How did you find out?
Ironically, we found out through you guys.
Through the media?
Yes. So I kid you not, we found out through my Twitter feed, you know, following you guys, and we saw this article as a couple people were forwarding us this article, and we heard nothing in advance prior to seeing that article in the news.
So I guess that was a little off-putting, finding out about it through everybody else and not have been contacted ahead of time.
That's correct. We thought it was maybe a joke, maybe a very, very late April Fool's Day joke. I mean, we had already gone through the stress of rebooking our wedding once, and then shortly afterward, this news came front. So it was very heartbreaking.
So you and your partner have filed a lawsuit to try and at least get your deposit back. Have you connected with other couples also in a similar situation? Is it a joint venture?
So we haven't filed a lawsuit as of this point, because we are still just wrapping up the bankruptcy proceedings that, you know, must happen when a company or a corporation files for bankruptcy. But since the bankruptcy proceedings have taken place, we have joined up with probably about another 50 couples in the exact same situation as Laura and I.
So there's a new wrinkle in this story since you last appeared on the program. It seems like a year ago, but with COVID, everything seems to fly by. Maybe it was longer than that. But we have been hearing now that that event space is available for bookings, but not through the original company.
That's correct. So it has been brought to our attention, and there's a lot of public common knowledge out there that Binghamton's is now hosting wedding events at that venue. And, you know, Binghamton's, we've confirmed, is not the owner. They are just simply leasing the space, from our understanding, to host events or to host weddings there. If, I guess, you know, people go to Binghamton's and they get to select where they want to have their wedding. And apparently the Hacienda venue is one of those options.
So has anybody from Hacienda contacted you since this arrangement was put into place? Because you think if they're renting out the facility, maybe that would be an avenue to get some of your money back, no?
No, we have had zero communication from the Hacienda event group. As far as we're concerned, the only communication we've had from that defunct event company was Nadine Doyle answering certain questions that we had through the bankruptcy creditors meeting and such like that. Other than that, zero communication whatsoever.
And I guess because Bigamins is just renting out the space, they don't own the building. Have you talked to them at all? Is there any hope at all at maybe getting a discount or something through them? I don't know. I'm just wondering.
Yeah, we've had several of the couples reach out to Bingamans asking if they were the ones that purchased the property, maybe privately, that we haven't seen. And Bingamans was, the representatives from Bingamans that chatted with some of the affected couples were strictly saying that they were just simply renting out the space. They had no ties to the ownership. They had no ties to, you know, owning the property. They were just simply going through the owner of that property to host the, you know, host events there. So Bingamans, as far as we're concerned, hasn't, you know, reached out to us to, you know, offer any discounts or, you know, services to the affected couples or the affected couples that are still yet to get married. And truthfully, I'm not really sure how many of the affected couples would really want to still have their wedding at Hacienda given everything that's gone on in the past year and a half.
Yeah, that's a really good point. Are you hopeful at all that maybe the ball has started to roll again?
Well, as of this point, we're not hopeful that we're, I would say, willingly going to recuperate any of the lost deposits that have come back. And as of this point, we're just simply waiting for the bankruptcy proceedings and the formalities that go along with that to finish so we can take appropriate next steps to, you know, try to get justice served and also recuperate the deposits that we lost, in addition to other damages mm-hmm. that are quite substantial for a lot of other couples.
Now, earlier in the interview, you referred to your partner as your wife. Have you gotten married somewhere else?
Yes, we did get married last year at the Allura Mill.
And how was that?
It was beautiful. It was perfect. It was, ironically, about 6 days after we went into the modified phase three. So we were allowed to have more than basically Laura and I, our officiant and our two groomsmen parties and bridesmaids parties. But it was wonderful.
So in speaking with some of the other couples, what are some of their concerns? Have there been any crazy stories?
Well, the main concerns at this point, you know, just given the recent news about Bingamans renting the event space, is we feel extremely disappointed, and mm-hmm. a lot of us feel extremely disgusted as well, because it just seems to us at this point that, yes, the Hacienda Saria event company is now bankrupt. There is, you know, clearly going to be no recuperation of deposits lost. But, you know, it is public knowledge that the owner of the Hacienda event company does have direct, you know, family ties to the ownership of that mm-hmm. property. And it just seems now that she's just gone and continued her business as is, you know, like speculating maybe under a different corporation or whatnot. But mm-hmm. at the end of the day, it just seems like, you know, they're just going back to business as usual. So, you know, for us, what was, you know, ultimately even more shocking was such a reputable name such as Bingamans, who clearly knows what has gone on at the site and what is still ongoing, mm-hmm. you know, has still willingly chosen to use that venue to, you know, schedule weddings and whatnot. It just seems that, you know, a lot of people are turning a blind eye to the fact that $1 million has completely evaporated. Mm-hmm. And it just seems like there's zero concern about that.
Right. Yeah. And anybody associated with the property might be putting their name in danger, even if they weren't originally involved. But people just hear the word Hacienda and they think, stay away from that place.
Yeah, exactly. It's quite shocking, you know, for so many different reasons. And, you know, if we do actually go with a formal, you know, commercial lawsuit against the bankrupt company and potentially, you know, other officers that are named in that corporation, it's not going to look well to, you know, a court system that knows, okay, they, you know, basically dissolved $1 million in deposits. And then what, a year and a half later, they're just back to doing business again, as nothing ever happened.
Mitch, thanks very much for your time this morning.
Thanks very much, Paulie.
Mitch Taylor and his now wife, you can hear that they fixed the marriage situation, but they are now married, but they were supposed to get married a couple of years ago at the Hacienda Serrera. Is that how you pronounce it? Yeah, the Hacienda. And they ended up declaring bankruptcy and are still struggling to get their deposit back. And we had Mitch on the program again, maybe a year and a half ago. Again, with COVID, everything just flies by. I can't even remember things that happened last week to me. Seem the same thing as things that happened 2 years ago. But anyway, Mitch has been on the show to discuss this situation. But the interesting wrinkle now is that the Hacienda event company, which had declared bankruptcy, seems to now be renting out the facility again in a roundabout way. So there is a deal with Bingham's. Of course, we're all familiar with Bingham's. Bingham's is using that space to rent out some of their own events as they see fit. If they need a building, then there is a deal with the Hacienda event company to host an event there. So if you do want to host an event at the Hacienda building, you have to go through Bingham's, essentially. But Mitch and his now wife are still in this lawsuit with the old Hacienda company trying to get their share. I mean, there was a number of couples, as you heard, a number of events that were canceled due to the bankruptcy of the Hacienda company. And they're trying to get their deposit back. And all of the events that were canceled, all of the people who are owed money, it's about $1 million in various deposits. And so the struggle continues with Mitch, his wife, and anybody else who is still trying to get a deposit back when the Hacienda declared bankruptcy. But it's interesting because... Now, I'm not a lawyer. I don't know a lot about legal proceedings, but it seems a little weird to me that you declare bankruptcy and then now all of a sudden you're willing to, you know, rent the space out again. So maybe some of that money can be used by Hacienda to repay some of the $1 million. So the struggle continues for Mitch, his wife, and many people. If you have a comment on this, we'd love to hear from you. 519-570-2545. Out of town, 1-800-570-5715. And star 570, hands free. This is the Mike Farwell Show with me, producer Paulie, filling in on City News 570 and Roger Stevie.
We know you have an opinion, so call the Mike Farwell Show, 519-570-2545, or toll free, 1-800-570-5715, and star 570.
There's always...
Wells Show on City News 570. Simulcast on Rogers TV, Cable 20.
There's a lot of public common knowledge out there that Binghamton's is now hosting wedding events at that venue. And, you know, Binghamton's, we've confirmed, is not the owner. They are just simply leasing the space, from our understanding, to host events or to host weddings there. If, I guess, you know, people go to Binghamton's and they get to select where they want to have their wedding. And apparently the Hacienda venue is one of those options.
Mitch Taylor joining us a few moments ago. He and his wife, Laura, and some of the other couples who lost their deposits after the Hacienda declared bankruptcy a couple years ago. Taylor was saying at this point, he and other creditors aren't expecting to see their donations return. And we've talked to Mitch before about his situation, but the interesting wrinkle now is that Binghamton's has a little deal with Hacienda, and Binghamton's is using that building to help rent out, you know, some of their events, which is, you know, that's cool for Binghamton's. You know, nothing against Binghamton's, but it is interesting that all these creditors are still owned $1 million from the old company who claims to be in bankruptcy, but now they are in a roundabout way renting out that space again. And have you ever been in a similar situation? Have you ever lost a deposit on something like that or tried to get it back? That might be an interesting topic of conversation if you want to weigh in at 519-570-2545. Out of town, 1-800-570-5715. And star 570, hands free. So coming up at 11:30, we have what we have called Free Phones with Farwell, even though it says on my sheet here, Free Phones with Producer Pauly. But it is still the Mike Farwell Show. So Producer Pauly filling in. So yeah, a half an hour of anything you want to talk about from 11:30 till noon. We've heard, you know, people miss sometimes some of the talk shows seem a little bit interview heavy at times. And, we hear on Twitter and through email and stuff, you know, we need more opportunities for people to call in. And of course, so we have Rant or Rave Mondays from 11 till noon. We've been doing that for years. It's gone under different names over the years, but currently it's called Rant or Rave. And then we have been doing Free Phones Friday on Kitchener Today, Fridays from 2 to 3 p.m. And that was something that Brian used to do all the time. Now, we have different rotating hosts, and depending on who the rotating host is on any given Friday, maybe they want to do Free Phones Friday, maybe they don't. I love taking calls from people. So whenever I've hosted lately on a Friday, I've always done the Free Phones Friday. But, you know, to each their own. But, yeah, so open phones coming up between 11:30 and noon. Again, anything you want to talk about, anything is on the table, anything that's on your mind. And we'll throw out some topics as well, maybe to get some of the creative juices flowing. But yeah, that's happening from 11:30 till noon. Now, going back to our earlier topic, we started off at 9:30 today talking about this film, which is starting at the Princess Cinema tomorrow, actually. And it's called Rock This Town. And Betty Ann Keller joined us at 9:30. She's the producer of the film. And it chronicles some of the big names that played the Waterloo region back in the 60s and 70s. You know, when I first heard that there was a documentary coming out about, you know, the KW music scene, I thought, oh, okay, well, maybe it's you know, some of the local bands that have come out of here, you know, local indie music scene, maybe some of the smaller, you know, venues that we've seen, you know, the Starlight Social Club, which unfortunately is no longer with us. The Jane Bond in Uptown Waterloo, I haven't been there for quite a while, but I remember back in the 90s, they used to bring in some bands as well. I don't know if they're still doing that, but anyway, and so when I heard about this documentary, I thought, you know, some, you know, smaller bands. No, this is, you know, some big names played Waterloo region back in the 60s and 70s. Chuck Berry, Kiss, Led Zeppelin, Imagine Led Zeppelin playing the Kitchener Auditorium. It happened. It happened because the concert promoters, the people who knew people, my people will call your people, knew who to call and get some of these bands in. Now, in some cases, obviously, you know, some of these bands played KW before they ended up making it really, really big. But, they, you know, their star was rising. As a former employee here used to say, he used to talk about, well, I'm not going to hide his name. It was Glenn Peltier. Of course, now recently retired as of last August, but Glenn would always talk about it, particularly the young people coming into the newsroom. Oh, that guy's great. His star is rising, man. But anyway, yeah, some of these big bands that played KW, Chuck Berry, Kiss, Led Zeppelin, even Elton John played the University of Waterloo, if you can believe that, the small little auditorium at the University of Waterloo. And what happened was, he was just making it big. They booked the show. And between the time they booked the show and between the time the show was supposed to happen was Elton John's first smash hit. And so, yeah, you could not find a ticket in town for that event. And actually, I think when I talked to Betty Ann Keller a couple of weeks ago on Kitchener Today, she said they added more shows. And Elton John played the University of Waterloo for almost a week straight. You can imagine the demand for that. So free phones with Farwell coming up. Anything you want to talk about, give us a call now. 519-570-2545 out of town. 1-800-570-5715. Anything you want to talk about is fair game for the next 30 minutes. Get it off your chest and on the radio. This is the Mike Farwell Show. Producer Pauly filling in on City News 570 and Rogers Television.
Hold that thought for a moment. We'll return with more of the Mike Farwell Show on City News 570, simulcast on Rogers TV, Cable 20.
We all.
Weather. This is City News 570 everywhere.
It's 11:30. Cloudy right now. We're sitting at 1 degree. Good morning. I'm Aaron Anderson with the City News 570 top story. Both a freezing rain warning and a special weather statement for strong wind gusts and heavy rain remain in effect for Waterloo Region and our surrounding areas today. The weather this morning prompted the Waterloo Region District and Catholic school boards to call off in-person classes and buses were canceled. The ice buildup also led Grand River Transit to implement a full ION service closure, meaning trains were not running between the Conestoga and Fairway stations. In an update this hour, a GRT spokesperson says service has been restored between the Fairway and Mill stations. Crews are working to clear ice from the rest of the route and get trains fully running again. Shuttle buses are operating in the remaining impacted areas in the interim. Riders can see the map on GRT's website. NATO is setting up new multinational battle groups of up to 1,500 troops in Hungary, Slovakia, Romania, and Bulgaria. Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg says they will remain in place as long as necessary to deter Russia from launching an attack on any of its members. Stoltenberg thinks NATO leaders meeting tomorrow in Brussels will likely agree to send more assistance to Ukraine, including equipment to help it protect against chemical, biological, and nuclear threats. Prime Minister Justin Trudeau will be attending the meeting, and later today will be speaking to the European Parliament. In sports, it's the Leafs and Devils in Toronto tonight. Broadcast time on City News, 7 o'clock. Starting at 8, the CHL-NHL Top Prospects game will get underway at the Odd. You can follow City News 570 on Twitter at City News KIT. News next at noon. I'm Aaron Anderson, City News.
This show's far from over. Mike still has plenty to say. The Mike Farwell Show's continuing right now on City News 570. Simulcast on Rogers TV, Cable 20.
Welcome back to the Mike Farwell Show here on City News 570. Producer Paulie in with you today on City News 570 and Rogers Television. So this is an open phones half hour. It's your half hour. We started doing this last week as people were asking for more open phones. So the time is yours. Call in now, 519-570-2545. Out of town, 1-800-570-5715. And star 570, hands-free. Anything you want to talk about is fair game for the next half hour. We have a few calls on the line now, just a couple of possible topics. Maybe you want to comment on this Liberal NDP coalition, although technically it's not a coalition. It's a voting agreement that was reached the other night between the federal Liberals and the federal NDP. My concern is, what are the Liberals going to try and push through now? Like, you know, like that controversial internet bill. Remember Bill C-10? We've talked about it on the show last year. It has made a reemergence and is now called Bill C-11. It's just moved up a number, but it's essentially the same bill. So what, you know, what's going to be tried to push through without much opposition in the next 2 or 3 years? I would also be curious to hear, if you've gone out shopping this week, of course, we have the mask mandate has been lifted in the province of Ontario. Most jurisdictions, I think, was it Mississauga or Oakville is still keeping it for another couple of weeks. Have you gone out shopping since Monday? Did you wear a mask? Did you not wear a mask? And did you feel weird? I went out shopping a little bit the other night, did not wear a mask, and I felt weird. Maybe I'll talk more about that later on in the half hour, or when I'm hosting Kitchener Today tomorrow. Maybe I'll open up the phones for a half an hour and just ask that question. Have you gone out shopping this week? What was it like? To the phones. Andy, go ahead.
Morning, how are you?
Good. What's your topic this half hour?
Not what you were suggesting. I just had a comment to make about the MRI machine.
Sure, yep, go ahead. Anything goes.
I was going to university a number of years ago, about 20 years ago, and taking a computer science class, and the guy there was working on programming those MRI machines.
Mm-hmm.
And I would have thought over 20 years, with miniaturization and microchips and everything like that, that we would have had cheaper MRI machines because they would have been around a lot longer.
Mm-hmm.
And miniaturized and, you know, made, perhaps made in foreign countries and stuff.
Right.
It just doesn't make sense to me that, what was the price tag, 10 or 20 million?
Well, they're hoping to raise $10 million for, so I'm guessing that's roughly the cost of a new MRI these days.
Hmm. Yeah.
So I don't. Maybe the price has come down. I mean, I don't know what MRIs would have gone for, you know, 30, 40 years ago. Maybe the price has come down. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, that's just my comment anyway. So.
All right, great. Thanks for the call, Andy. Yeah, it's things, at least big technological advancements like that tend to come down in price over time. Billy, go ahead. You're on Free Phones with Farwell.
Hi, my friend, Paulie.
How you doing?
Good. And I'd like to say hi to my friend, Mike, too.
Okay, I know who that is. That is a Billy that we don't want on the air. Billy, you know you're not supposed to call. You've been told this, so don't call. Mark, go ahead.
Good morning, Paulie. I heard you talking about Elton John there. He
played
in Waterloo.
Yes.
At the university. What was his first smash hit, Crocodile Rock?
I don't know what his first hit was. That might have been it. I guess I could pull up a list of chronological Elton John songs. Do you know what the first one was, Mark?
I'm just guessing. I'm thinking Crocodile Rock. I don't know.
You know what? I don't know. I can look that up during the break. Or
okay,
perhaps,
I've got another thing, Paulie.
Yeah.
That 44-story building on Francis there?
Yes.
I live about 15 kilometers away from that location.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll bet you any money, Paulie, I'll be able to see that building in the skyline.
Sorry, say that again?
I'll bet any money. I live 15 kilometers from that location.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll bet any money I'll be able to see the top of the building from my property in the skyline.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy. There's that really tall building at the corner of Duke and Frederick, and I can see that building when I'm driving in between Elora and Bloomingdale. Like, it's this towers over the whole city, and this new building is going to be four or five stories taller than that.
Right. Is that, I think you said, too, I heard you, is that the tallest now in KW?
I don't know that officially, but I can't possibly think of a building that's going to be taller than that 44-story tower.
Okay, one more thing, Paul.
Yep.
I seen Bob Dylan at the Kitchener Auditorium way back in the day. And, Paulie, that was the worst concert I've ever been to in my entire life.
Why was that?
Pardon me?
Why was it the worst concert ever?
He was into gospel at the time.
Oh, okay.
He didn't play any of his hits whatsoever. It was so boring. I think half the audience left halfway through.
Wow, and this was at the Odd, huh?
Correct.
Wow. Was this in his heyday? Like, were his biggest days still ahead of him at that point?
No, this was after he came up with all his hits.
Mm-hmm.
And then he just changed his format.
Okay, all right, cool. Thanks Mark.
Paulie.
Thanks. I'm looking up Elton John's singles here. I have a Wikipedia page up. And it's sometimes a little hard to discern because they have a chart here, the UK chart, the Australian chart, Canadian, US. It looks like Elton John's first really big hit was Your Song. And that would have been, looks like October of 1970. So assuming it was Your Song that really, catapulted Elton John onto the big music scene. It would have been Your Song in 1970. That would have been probably about the time that he played the University of Waterloo. Yeah, this film that's playing at the Princess Cinema starting tomorrow night called Rock This Town. My wife and I have tickets, and we're looking forward to going this weekend. Open phones, anything you want to talk about for the next few moments or so up until noon, 519-570-2545. Out of town, 1-800-570-5715. And star 570, hands-free. We call this Free Phones with Farwell, even though Farwell's not here today. Maybe you want to call about that. Free Phones with producer Paulie. Kyle, go ahead.
Hey, I had a random thought last night. I remember as a kid, I walked into a grocery store with my dad. Do you remember Nob Hill Farms in Cambridge?
Yeah, I went there a couple of times. Yeah. Had the big water fountains out front.
Yeah, and it was like, apparently it was the biggest, I guess at the time, the biggest grocery store. We still have the baskets from there.
The largest grocery store in the world at one point was Nob Hill Farms in Cambridge. Yeah, I don't have a basket, but I still see them around from time to time.
It's crazy the memories that you have as a kid.
Yeah.
So, anyways, I just wanted to ask that. I couldn't remember. Like, my dad was like, yeah, we used to go there all the time growing up, right? So I just didn't know if anybody else remembered it or not. But I think it's the new Home Depot and stuff is there, right?
That the something like is? That. There's a Home Depot. There's also a Canadian Tire on that same site.
Was that
as well,
like
so
a GO station or a train station at one point? Is that what it was? Like a warehouse? Was that what, is that what it was?
Do I don't ever remember a train station on that property. I mean, I'm not too much older than you, but no, Knob Hill Farms was on that corner for many, many, many years. I remember going there a couple of times when I was younger. I can't remember like what it was like, you know, on the inside, the layout or anything, but it was at one point billed as the world's largest grocery store.
Cool, cool. I just wanted to ask. Cool, thanks.
Paul. Yeah, and I wish that they would start up those water fountains, those three big towers right there on the corner of Hespler and, oh, it's not Eagle. Oh, boy, what is the side street there? Anyway, major intersection there at Hespler. I think anybody who's, you know, around my age or older will certainly know and remember Knob Hill Farms. And what's that intersection? Fast Eddie's is right there, too. I go to Fast Eddie's from time to time when I want a burger. There you go, the Fast Eddie's corner. But I can't even say that, right? Because I think there's three of them in Cambridge now, right? So that doesn't help anybody else out. Okay, free phones with Farwell, 519-570-2545. Out of town, 1-800-570-5715. And star 570, get it off your chest and on the radio. Scott, go ahead.
Good morning.
What do you want to talk about?
Well, I just wanted to add to our famous artists that played in Kitchener-Waterloo.
Yeah.
I believe the Guess Who played here.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe that Burton Cummings came back as a solo act.
Okay.
And I believe Ozzy Osbourne played.
Oh, wow. That would have been a cool show to see, yeah.
And if I recall, David Wilcox played a lot of events.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Stephen Wilcox is Canadian, is he not?
I don't know if David Wilcox is Canadian. I believe
David
he is.
David Wilcox, yeah. I thought, for some reason, I think he is. But, yeah, and I think, of course, the most famous story, I think, in rock and roll, I think, I don't know how common knowledge this is. I've been aware of it for a while, but the Guess Who song, American Woman, was written in the middle of a concert in Waterloo. Did you know that?
Yes. And
yeah.
Somebody in the stands was pirating and recording it.
Oh, okay.
And because they never knew the words after they sang it the first time.
Oh, so if it weren't for that pirate recording, they might not even have been able to recreate the song for an album.
Yeah, they just sort of winged it.
I didn't know that. If I recall the story correctly, I guess the guitar had broken in the middle of the concert, and that's a riff they came up with to retune the guitar, and they had to do it right in the middle of the concert with the crowd there, right?
I believe so.
Yeah. Okay, cool. Thanks a lot, Scott.
Okay, have a great day.
You too. Ozzy Osbourne playing Waterloo Region. That would have been cool to see for sure. It is Free Phones with Farwell on the Mike Farwell Show here on City News 570. Charlie, go ahead.
Hey, Paul. Just a couple words about Jagmeet Singh and his total capitulation of the federal liberals.
Yeah.
Paul, you know, I saw Mr. Singh on TV yesterday, and he was happy working with Mr. Trudeau on affordable housing. Get that. Look at all the work they've done for affordable housing. Have they ever taken a look at the prices of affordable housing? But anyhow, that's an aside.
Yeah.
I could rant on and on about Jagmeet Singh and his useless bunch of dippers, but the real surprise to me is that these gullible dippers actually believe that Trudeau liberals will keep their end of the deal. They actually believe that. In fact, I think perhaps Justin could put a leash around Jagmeet and pull him around as his personal lapdog.
Mm-hmm.
They got nothing out of the deal, Paul.
Yeah, it's...
They got a few promises, and that was it. They got no cabinet minister, nothing.
Yeah, I'm going to be interested to see what happens, as I was mentioning before. Now, everyone looks out for their own self-interest, so... A point comes where the NDP deem that it's not in their best interest to keep supporting the Liberals, and they can just pull out of that deal whenever they want, really, because there is no formal agreement. It's just kind of, I think, an agreement kind of in principle that the NDP will support the Liberals, and in exchange for the Liberals bringing forward some of the things that the NDP has been asking for many, many years, things like, you know, universal pharmacare and things like that. But I don't think this little coalition or whatever you're going to call it, I don't think it's going to last until the next scheduled election, which is what, in 2025? I think it's going to, the coalition anyway will break before that. Whether or not it'll trigger an election, obviously, is another thing. But interesting times, and Canadian politics is never boring. Jim, go ahead.
Good morning, Paulie. My phone call is regarding the people of the city of Kitchener and Waterloo. Mm-hmm. The garbage is unbelievable.
I was noticing that the other day after all the snow has melted, there's garbage everywhere, yeah.
It's unbelievable. My wife and I have been out picking up garbage, and I think we picked up in the last 2-3 weeks, the garbage we could see, we got about 16 bags of garbage. It's ridiculous, and there's still so much out there, it's unbelievable.
Is this something you do every year with your wife, Jim?
No, we go out and because we walk every day because we're retired.
Yeah.
So we take a grocery buggy with a bunch of plastic bags, black garbage bags, and we have these grippers that we pick the garbage up off.
Right, that's great, yeah.
And we wear rubber gloves so we don't have to touch the garbage.
Yeah.
But between the garbage and the dog feces is just brutal.
Is it worse this year than in prior years, do you think?
I think it's worse this year than I've ever seen because you can drive down the street anywhere you want and there's garbage everywhere.
Yeah, and on the boulevards and things, yeah.
And this is totally disgusting.
Mm-hmm.
People don't take pride in their city or their neighborhoods. It's just unbelievable.
Yeah, it really bothers me when I'm driving down the highway or whatever and there's a car in front of me and they just throw a coffee cup out the window. Come on, people, pick up your trash. John, go ahead.
Good morning, producer Paulie. I, first of all, would like to totally agree with your previous caller. The garbage this year is just, it's terrible.
Yeah.
All food in Waterloo region, just terrible. But I'd like to go back to some comments about the music scene in the KW area.
Yeah.
Which, I want to give a shout out to a gentleman I call the Instigator.
Okay.
His name is Glenn Smith. He runs the Ethel's Lounge right now.
Yep.
But if you go back in history, he had the insight, the smarts, to bring in the one and only Mel Brown to our town.
Yes.
And yes.
Mel Brown and the Home Wreckers. Is that his band?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. And you know, he ran Pop the Gator, Glenn Smith did. But that's why I call him the Instigator. And Mel has been a big, big influence on so many great musicians that we've been able to see in the KW area and then that have gone outside our region. But Glenn Smith is I like to call him the Instigator because of what he did, the insight in bringing Mel Brown to town. And one more comment, Paulie. Yep. I was trying to get my wife to mention this, but she's too shy. She says she hopes Rogers has the insight to make producer Paulie a full-time host.
Thank you. That's very nice, John. Thank you. I'm very flattered when people say that. I'm glad you're enjoying when I've been hosting here on and off over the last couple of weeks. This is the Mike Farwell Show. We still have time for a couple of more calls coming up. This is Rogers TV and City News 570.
It's a give and take. Mike gives you a chance to call, and we get to hear your take. Call 519-570-2545 or 1-800-570-5715. More of the Mike Farwell Show after this. Some people prefer to live... This is the Mike Farwell Show on City News 570. Simulcast on Rogers TV, Cable 20.
All right, let's do a lightning round here of callers. We got 4 minutes, and we got four callers. So let's keep it quick, everybody. Murray, go ahead. You're on the air, Murray.
Hey, listen, I've been to a lot of concerts. I've seen Pink Floyd in Toronto. That was pretty cool. Mm-hmm. I've seen Elton John and Billy Joel together. That was nice.
Yeah.
But, listen, you guys keep talking about that concert at the center of the square. That was 1980, 81, Ozzy Osbourne, Blizzard of Oz tour. I was there, buddy, about 30 or 40th row. Right dead center. I had the cables for the sound system right at my feet on my left foot.
Yeah.
Right about maybe, say, 20 rows up behind me was the sound system, guys. It was an amazing concert.
Nice.
That was before, I'm telling you, I was, 17 or something. We were still in high school, a whole bunch of us went. We couldn't hear nothing for like 2 days.
Wow. Nice. Cool. Thanks for the call, Murray. Yeah, Ozzy Osbourne at the center in the square. Andre, go ahead.
Yes, good afternoon, Producer Paulie. I wanted to talk about the MRI.
Mm-hmm.
I went probably nine times because of my injury, and I go every 2 years for my spine. But I totally agree with it would be nice if Cambridge would have their machine. And for the previous caller, like cars, technology don't go down. It would be nice, but no, like cars, everything goes up.
Yeah, well, some technology, like look at VCRs, right? When VCRs came out in the late 70s, even when you take into account inflation, they were a lot more expensive back then than they ended up being in the 80s and 90s. Of course, can't find a VCR anywhere. You can't even find a DVD player anymore. Even that technology is outdated. Everybody's streaming everything. Steve, go ahead.
Hey, Paul. How's it going, brother?
Good. What do you got for us?
Just two things. A couple quick ones, man. 2005, September 11th, Pearl Jam at the Kitchener Memorial Auditorium.
Yeah.
The building I grew up playing hockey, football in. It was the best day of my damn life. We were there at 7 o'clock in the morning throwing the football around, me and Gregor.
Nice.
Awesome day. The Tragically Hip at the Auditorium, I don't know, 10 years ago or something. They're both sweaty-ass nights. I can't barely remember, but all the love in my heart. And Maestro Fresh West back at the old Metropolis.
Yeah, Wow, there's two old names you haven't heard for a while. Maestro Fresh West and the Metropolis.
Yes, sir. Yeah, it was a great time. Man, the floor was bouncing. We thought it was going to cave in. It was such a good night. But
nice.
Pearl Jam at the Odd, Tragically Hip at the Odd. Makes me cry every time I think about it. Take care, buddy.
Great. Thanks a lot, Steve. I think the Metropolis burnt down, unfortunately, in the late 90s, did it not? Used to be a movie theater. Let's take one more, then we got to get out of here. Norma, go ahead. What do you have?
Oh, I just wanted to help you out with your Cambridge geography.
Oh, yeah.
Love, not so. I wish it was still there, but it's Pine Bush.
Yes.
Pine Bush.
Pine Bush, yes.
On the Knoxville side.
Yeah.
And it's Eagle Street on the Fast Eddie side.
Right. Yes.
It
yes.
changes names.
Yes. Thank you very much, Norma. Yeah. See, Pine Bush. It was right on the tip of my tongue. So there you go. Okay. I am out of here. I survived another 3 hours on the air, and the big hook, as it were, didn't come through the door. It's a miracle. So we have Kitchener Today coming up next with Brittle Star. You may have heard him host last week. Got a lot of great comments. Brittle Star, a social media sensation from Stratford. I bet you a lot of people don't know that, but Brittle Star is coming up today on Kitchener Today. So that's it. So hopefully Mike Farwell will be back tomorrow. We'll have to see. This has been the Mike Farwell Show with myself, producer Paulie, filling in on City News 570 and Rogers TV.
CKGLAM Kitchener, broadcasting live from the Boardwalk. Breaking news, traffic, and weather.
returns for season two. We have a terrific lineup coming up for you. We will be interviewing folks like gallery owners, musicians, a theater impresario, a master Japanese calligrapher, and much more. So watch On the Art Trail with Joanne, Saturdays at 7.
Are you interested in learning TV production? Have you ever wanted your own TV show? There's an opportunity waiting for you at Rogers TV. On Friday, April 8th, visit us on location at the Sleeman Center and find out how you can get involved with Rogers TV. From working on our OHL broadcasts and daily shows to pitching and producing your own show, discover how you can be part of community TV. Details at RogersTV.com.
Sometimes, for a wish to come true, it takes a kingdom. Because together we're stronger. Tied tight, united we stand. In honor of one child's wish, to fuel the fire that will grant many more. Join the kingdom.
Watching Rogers TV.